If you have even had a whiff of calculus, you have seen something like this. Here's a curve, and I ask you to draw a tangent line at this point. Here's how I would do it. I can almost guarantee that the line that you drew in your head would look pretty much the same. You have also heard your professors recite this chant which still echoes in your troubled slumbers: the derivative at a point is the slope of the tangent line at that point. But what really is a tangent line? Derivatives are important in all sort of real-world problems, and so this elevates the significance of this mysterious object. But why did we draw this particular line? What feels so right about it? If I were to ask my friend, I mean computer, to draw this line, what instructions would I give? I can't just ask it to eyeball it, for obvious reasons. So the answer seems to be that to make this line, I need to first calculate the derivative, which can be approximated on a computer, and then draw a line passing through this point of slope equal to the derivative. And this is my main issue with how we teach tangent lines. We introduce this magical object of a tangent line and then define this very important notion of derivatives using its help. You may have seen a tangent line being constructed as a limit of secant lines, but this construction is secretly two separate limits. The points are separately getting closer, and the slope of the secants is becoming the slope of the tangents, which is just the derivative. So to even define a tangent line, we have to use derivatives in the first place. Which makes this all circular, right? But I understand why we do it. The title of this video isn't simply you were taught tangents wrong, but rather why you were taught them wrong. So here's what I think. At the point when derivatives are introduced in a course, a fresh calculus student is already struggling with the idea of limits. So, if you throw this very abstract limit at them, you're likely to lose about half of your class. And if you show them a picture of a tangent later, then the context has already become so muddled in their minds that this picture means nothing to them anymore. So the way we do it is by connecting two ideas that they already know, limits and slopes, and serving them on the platter of this deceitful picture that we hope that they don't question too deeply. So this statement that defines the derivative as slope of the tangent is sort of like defining a lemon by what goes inside a lemonade. Which, if lemons look like this, I would understand. So in the world of calculus, it might be more correct to first define the derivative as a limit, and then say that the tangent line of f at x equal to a is a line passing through a, f of a, with the slope equal to the derivative of f at x equal to a. None of the formulations are wrong, but the latter one feels more causal than the other. But this resolution is dissatisfying to me. Let me tell you why I started thinking about this stuff in the first place. If you have a tangent line L to F and M to G at x equal to a, then how can you combine these two lines to produce a tangent line to the function F times G at x equal to a? The product rule tells us that the new slope is the weighted sum of old slopes. So, just by looking at the geometric data of L and M, could we figure out this new tangent line without using any limits or derivatives? To convince you why this is interesting, take any two differentiable functions that pass through zero. Their tangent line slopes could be anything, but the tangent at the origin of their product will always be a flat line, that is, the x-axis. I can easily prove this using derivatives, but I was curious if I could prove this using geometry. After asking some articles and reading some people, it turns out it might not be possible to define tangents in a general Euclidean geometric sense. But I would still like to offer you two compromises. The first one comes from Earl Bivens' article, What a Tangent Line Is If It Isn't a Limit, and has inspired my exposition for this video. The introduction to this article is so well written and requires minimal mathematical prerequisites. Consider this gem, where he talks about student reactions to introducing the limit definition of the derivative. Yet, to many students, this is probably a rather unsatisfactory state of affairs. The idea of the tangent line, which initially seemed so geometrical and intuitive, has suddenly receded into the shadows of abstraction. Its behavior is much like that of a faint star, which, when looked at directly, disappears. He defines a tangent line as the best linear approximation of a function around the point x equal to a. In a calculus course, this is often introduced as an application of derivatives under the topic of linearization. If you look closely at a point, then the tangent line is the line that is the closest to the curve. He claims that we already had this intuition, as this is how we drew the tangent line in the first example. We tried to guess the line that best approximates the curve. He uses this to prove tangent lines of some well-known curves. He points out a classic error of claiming that the absolute value function has no tangent line at x equal to 0 because it has infinitely many tangent lines at x equal to 0, which is just absurd. He instead calls these bounding lines, which is a line for which a function lies entirely on one side. He uses this idea to build tangent lines and eventually connects it to derivatives. Another slightly more geometric idea comes from Hugh Thurston's article on the definition of a tangent line. If you zoom into any nice enough function at a point x equal to a, you will see that it gets flatter and starts looking like its tangent line at that point. This definition roughly says that the closer the point of your choice p is to a, the lesser the angle this line will make to the tangent. This can then be used as a starting point to show that the tangent line defined by the derivative indeed satisfies this condition. This definition is actually even more general, and this tangent can exist even when the derivative doesn't. Of course, I'm sliding under the rug a lot of heavy math and subtleties, such as what does the word close or zoom in mean. But I hope this can give you a taste of how we can make the tangent feel more geometric. If you're interested in the dirty math, I will add some discussion and a link to my blog post in the description. These ideas that we discussed help us ground the fuzzy notion of what a tangent is. So the next time you say the derivative is the slope of the tangent line, you can be rest assured that the tangent line actually exists, and the spirits of the geometric land are protecting you. The common issue with both of these approaches, however, is that they prove the tangent line exists and they characterize the tangent line geometrically, but they never actually find what it is. To find the slope of the tangent line, we have to go back to limits and derivatives, which is what handles the numerics. So sadly, geometry can tell me that the product rule works, but it will not find it for me. The existence of a tangent line, as it turns out, was the convenient truth that I had accepted, just because it worked for me. The more I teach, the more I learn about these convenient truths that have etched into my brain. And until you rip the walls by questioning, it is hard to know how deeply entrenched they are. I don't believe this video challenges or negates anything that we all have learned. I also don't blame anyone for holding any sort of convenient truths. If the nagging curiosity of a student or a teacher prods the framework and the framework shakes, then it might be a good time to step out of that framework and analyze what's happening. I have seen many people practice what Bivens calls intimidation, which is basically like, you know what a tangent line is, right? Just take a look at it. And this, Bivens says, leads to a battle of intuitions, which can only be won by authority. I think there's more beauty in the discomfort experience in the pursuit of inquiry rather than in the comfort of embraced beliefs. And I think that's all I had. Thanks for watching.